Hello, students of Dynamics. This is Dr. Dan Baker with another video today talking about fixed axis rotation and specifically no-slip wheels, which also applies to gears and also pulleys or chain drive systems. We'll talk about that as we move through it. All right, so both of these bodies that we're going to look at today, let's call one of these body A, the other one body B. It is important for these relationships that both of these wheels are in fixed axis rotation about their centers. There are relative velocity equations that you can use to relate, say, a wheel rolling across the ground, which fundamentally has a different type of motion than a wheel rolling about its center. But what we're looking at today is wheels which are rotating about their middles. Okay, so one thing we'll notice is there's going to be a contact point here right between these. Let's call that point P. And the important relationship between these two wheels is that this contact point is non-slip. And essentially in a non-slip condition, what we're going to do is we're going to transfer the velocity of one body onto the body of the other. So let's say that we're given the omega here of body A, and that's going to be negative from the right-hand rule. So if it is rotating in that direction here, we could fairly easily see that our velocity, call this the velocity of point P, is going to be kind of down, mainly down a little bit to the left. Now this can be also true for body B, right? Because this contact point is transferring the velocity between these two points because it's not slipping at that point. So we also could add on to here that we end up with an omega B in the opposite direction as omega A, okay? Positive from the right-hand rule. Now we do need some dimensions here. Let's add those in. Let's say that this top body here, A, has a radius of A and B has a radius of B. All right, so you'll remember from your fixed axis rotation equations that our velocity is equal to omega times r. Now that's the scalar form of the vector equation. V is equal to omega cross r. And the reason we can use the scalar form is that our velocity is perpendicular to our r. And so therefore, we can go ahead and use the scalar product. Also to note even that our omega is perpendicular to our r as well, right? So all these terms, all three are perpendicular to each other, so we can use the scalar form. And so using the scalar form, I can write that my velocity at point P is equal to my omega of A times my radius at A, which is also equal to my omega of B times my radius of point B. Okay, so I like this form of the equation because I don't have to remember any fractions. I don't have to remember any details about what goes with what. I know all my A's are on the left, all my B's are on the right, and then I can solve for whatever I'd like to, right? So say that you're given omega A and need to solve for omega B, you'd move your RA over on the other side. Okay. Now, it also turns out that the same equation is true for accelerations. Now, let's say that this wheel A is slowing down. Okay, so the angular acceleration alpha of A is positive from the right-hand rule. And if that is true, then we could also map onto here that our acceleration of point P tangential, which is a vector, go ahead and label all these terms here just to be explicit that these are all vector terms. I think I could cut all of them there. So here is our tangential acceleration at this contact point. Now, if you're wondering how we'd end up with that acceleration, just to review here, let me go ahead and draw this r vector instead of just to an arbitrary point. Let's go ahead and draw it to point P. Okay, so this is going to be my r of P as a vector. And so if we cross this alpha, curling our fingers around, our thumb comes out of the page or out of the screen. And then we're going to cross that, curling our fingers into the R vector or using your three-finger cross product, you should end up with this tangential acceleration, right? And that comes from the equation that our A sub T is equal to alpha cross R. Now again, because we know that alpha is perpendicular to r, this should have a vector as well. It's a vector form. Then we can go ahead and write this in the scalar form. A sub t is equal to alpha times r. And using that form and then making it specific to this problem, we can say the acceleration of point P tangential is equal to our alpha A RA is also equal to our alpha B RB. So this is another equation which we can use to compute the ratio of our alphas, and it ends up being a ratio of the radiuses. Right, that really determines that ratio between the alphas. Now, a final equation that we could add on to this, we've taken care of our velocity, our acceleration. We can also write one of these equations for displacement. And so it also turns out for displacement that our theta sub a times ra is equal to our theta b rb, where theta is referring to the angular displacement. Okay, so the same ratios between angular displacement, velocity, and acceleration. So in one way, you can think of this as being similar to constrained motion pulleys, which we dealt with for particles and dynamics. And we ended up with a ratio of velocities was the same ratio for positions, the same ratio for accelerations. And we see that same thing for angular motion of these two non-slip bodies in fixed axis rotation. All right, just to show briefly that this also works for bodies that aren't directly touching. Now let's look at these two pulleys, both also in fixed axis rotation. So a pin here in the middle, a pin in the middle of this one. Now, if we go ahead and connect these with either a chain or a belt, which is going to run tangential to each one of those circles. One thing to notice, if those are coming off tangentially, we could say that this is now my RA coming back this direction here. This would be my RB. And we would see that if the front wheel here was rotating in this direction, so let's call that omega of A. So given that angular velocity, we can go ahead and draw a linear velocity. Now the linear velocity needs to come off here, also tangential, in line actually with that belt. So this would be my velocity of A. Now that's very specific to this point on A. Now the outside, anywhere on that outside ring of A would have the exact same magnitude of velocity, just be going in a different direction. Now it also turns out that we can transfer that over here to point B. Once again, add a tangential line along the line of that belt or chain. So this would be, call this VB, but it turns out also to equal VA. Okay, so the key thing here is that this red dot on both bodies is exactly the same velocity. Another thing to notice is that in a chain drive or a belt system like we're showing here, it turns out the wheels now, instead of having opposite omegas, have the same direction omega. And this should be fairly intuitive. If you've ever ridden a bike that has gears, or even without gears, in a single speed bike, you've seen this happen, right? Where you have a front chain ring and a back sprocket as well, and you're basically getting a gear ratio. And the ratio ends up being a ratio of these two radiuses, right? The ratio of the front to the back, or the back to the front. So you can use these same relationships, whether it's for velocity, for slowing down. Let's go ahead and map those on real quick. Let's say that alpha A is opposite omega A, so we're slowing that angular velocity down with angular acceleration. Then my acceleration, A sub T, would be going back this direction in the same way that my red dot here again would have an A sub T going the opposite direction. Now we've covered velocity, we've covered tangential acceleration. Let's take a quickly look at the normal acceleration. Normal acceleration always goes back toward the center of curvature, right? So this would be my AN sub A, and here would be my AN sub B. So I want you to think here quickly about whether you think that AN sub A or B would be larger. Okay, the question is, how does AN sub A as a magnitude compare to AN sub B, the normal accelerations of these two red dots? Go ahead and pause the video if you're watching this online. All right, coming back from that reflection, if you think about what makes up these normal accelerations. We can think about them with two different equations. One of those would be v squared over rho, which is also going to be equal to r omega squared times r or rho. We tended to use this first form for particles. We tend to use this second form for rigid bodies. So as we think about the motion here, if we have the same velocity at those contact points, we're going to end up with a larger omega b than omega a. And so if we square that term times even a smaller radius, but this term here is going to increase much quicker, it turns out that the normal acceleration of the smaller wheel will always be larger. Okay, and you can justify that normal acceleration is the acceleration needed to hold a point in a curved path. The curved path in this case has a tighter radius. If it has a tighter radius, it's going to need a larger acceleration to stay in that very tight radius. As you relax the radius and make it larger and larger, like this bigger wheel here, you need a smaller normal acceleration to stay in that curve. Okay, we could apply the same thing here above. Looking at these normal accelerations, we would have a normal acceleration here, call this acceleration. Now here I'm going to add a point P on B sub n. Sorry for the triple subscript there, but it is necessary because we have a different value there than we do on this body. My acceleration of point P on body A sub n. Okay, and once again, our larger acceleration of the two is going to be our normal on the smaller wheel, same velocity, but with a tighter radius that's moving around. Hope that helps you to understand these fixed axis rotation problems with no slip wheels, gears, or chain or belt drives. I appreciate your time.